Our final stop today is the Indo-Pacific Coral Reef. The Indo-Pacific is often referred to as the Coral Triangle because this region of the world is home to over 500 species of reef-building coral. This is one of only two living exhibits in the entire museum and features a wide variety of marine species representing the diverse and complex community on a coral reef, including about 60 species of coral. This tank, installed in 2008, is approximately 1,600 gallons. As we take a closer look, look for some of the amazing creatures that call this exhibit home. To the left is a relatively large blue fish with a small mouth. This is a Vlamingi tang, also known as the big-nose unicorn fish. And who do you see who is hiding just under the coral? It is the famous orange and white striped clownfish. We can find some other species of fish in the tank as well. Some species you might see are yellow tangs in the bottom right tank and a pajama cardinal fish in the middle of the tank. Along with many different species of fish, this tank is home to marine invertebrates, or animals without backbones, including sea urchins, brittle stars, and a giant clam. Coral reefs, while covering only about 1% of the Earth's surface, support about 25% of marine biodiversity, making them hugely important. But unfortunately, corals around the world are suffering due to stresses like pollution, trampling, ocean acidification, and ocean warming due to climate change. While they may look like rocks, corals are actually unique, fragile invertebrate animals. Within the bodies of the corals in this tank, live tiny plants called zooxanthellae. While corals are carnivores that can feed on small animals, organic particles, and even some tiny fish, up to 90% of their energy needs can be met by these plants. Because of this, many of the coral species that build reefs like to live in the warm, tropical, clear waters of the Indo-Pacific or the Caribbean. But this relationship between corals and plants is very fragile. When ocean temperatures spike, corals under stress expel these tiny plants from their tissues. And because corals get their brilliant colors from their zooxanthellae, when the plants are forced out, the corals appear white, which is why this phenomenon is known as coral bleaching. As climate change impacts our ocean, ocean heat waves are becoming more common and more severe. This is leading to extended periods of coral bleaching. And if conditions do not improve, corals without zooxanthellae will eventually die. On the Great Barrier Reef in Australia, about 50% of corals have died during extended bleaching events in 2016 and 2017. Sometimes visitors notice that the tips of the corals in this tank appear slightly white and ask if our corals are bleached. Luckily, this is actually because conditions in our tank are kept so pristine that corals are growing too fast for the plants to keep up, which means they're very healthy. But in the wilds, coral bleaching has significant effects on the animals and plants that rely on the reef and the health of the ocean as a whole. Scientists around the world, including those at the Smithsonian, are working hard to understand how these events occur and what we can do to help make corals resilient to these changes. Researchers at the Caribou-Kay Field Station in Belize, the Smithsonian Marine Station in Fort Pierce, Florida, and here at the museum in Washington, D.C., are working on projects to better understand and protect our world's corals. To learn more about their research, you can check out the Coral Reef feature on the Smithsonian Ocean Portal.